Wildfire by Zane Grey. Chapter 1. For some reason, the desert scene before Lucy Bostil awoke varying emotions. A sweet gratitude for the fullness of her life there at the ford, yet a haunting remorse that she could not be wholly content. A vague loneliness of soul, a thrill and a fear for the strangely calling future, glorious, unknown. She longed for something to happen. It might be terrible, so long as it was wonderful. This day, when Lucy had stolen away on a forbidden horse, she was 18 years old. The thought of her mother, who had died long ago on their way into this wilderness, was the one drop of sadness in her joy. Lucy loved everybody at Bostil's Ford, and everybody loved her. She loved all the horses except her father's favorite racer, that perverse devil of a horse, the great Sage King. Lucy was glowing and rapt with love for all she beheld from her lofty perch, the green and pink blossoming hamlet beneath her, set between the beauty of the gray sage expanse and the ghastliness of the barren heights, the swift Colorado sullenly thundering below in the abyss, the Indians in their bright colors riding up the river trail, the eagle poised like a feather on the air, and a mile beneath him the grazing cattle making black dots on the sage, the deep velvet azure of the sky, the golden lights on the bare peaks and the lilac vales in the far ravines, the silky rustle of a canyon swallow as he shot downward in the sweep of the wind, the fragrance of cedar, the flowers of the spear-pointed mescal, the brooding silence, the beckoning range, the purple distance. Whatever it was Lucy longed for, whatever was whispered by the wind and written in the mystery of the waste of sage and stone, she wanted it to happen there at Bostil's Ford. She had no desire for civilization. She flouted the idea of marrying the rich ranger of Durango, Bostil's sister, that stern but lovable woman who had brought her up and taught her, would never persuade her to marry against her will. Lucy imagined herself like a wild horse, free, proud, untamed, meant for the desert. And here she would live her life. The desert and her life seemed as one, yet in what did they resemble each other? In what part of this scene could she read the nature of her future? Shudderingly, she rejected the red, sullen, thundering river with its swift, changeful, endless, contending strife, for that was tragic. And she rejected the frowning mass of red rock, upreared, riven, and split and canyoned, so grim and aloof, for that was barren. But she accepted the vast, sloping valley of sage, rolling gray and soft and beautiful, down to the dim mountains and purple ramparts of the horizon. Lucy did not know what she yearned for. She did not know why the desert called to her. She did not know in what it resembled her spirit. But she did know that these three feelings were as one, deep in her heart. For 10 years, every day of her life, she had watched this desert scene, and never had there been an hour that it was not different, yet the same. 10 years. And she grew up watching, feeling, till from the desert's thousand moods she assimilated its nature, loved her bonds, and could never have been happy away from the open, the color, the freedom, the wildness. On this birthday, when those who loved her said she had become her own mistress, she acknowledged the claim of the desert forever. And she experienced a deep, rich, strange happiness. Hers always, then, the mutable and immutable desert, the leagues and leagues of slope and sage, and rolling ridge, the great canyons and the giant cliffs, the dark river with its mystic thunder of waters, the pine-fringed plateaus, the endless stretch of horizon with its lofty, isolated, noble monuments, and the bold ramparts with their beckoning beyond. Hers always.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.